طارق الخلائق أجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين والصلاة والسلام على أنبياء الله جميعا وعلى سيدهم وخاتمهم حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين وعلى سيدنا ومولانا الإمام أبي عبد الله جعفر بن محمد الصادق عليه الصلاة والسلام.
اللهم صل على محمد.
قال تعالى في كتابه الكريم: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ألم تر كيف ضرب الله مثلا كلمة طيبة كشجرة طيبة أصلها ثابت وفرعها في السماء تؤتي أكلها كل حين بإذن ربها ويضرب الله الأمثال للناس لعلهم يتذكرون، صدق الله العلي العظيم.
اللهم صل على محمد.
2 days ago was the anniversary of the martyrdom of one of the most important iconic figure and a legendary in the history of Islam and the history of mankind. And that is our sixth Imam and the sixth successor to the Prophet, Al-Imam Ja'far ibn Muhammad al-Saddiq alayhi salatu
wassalam.
Why this man, this leader, this Imam is important to us, especially in the school of Ahlul Bayt? We have been named after him. Our tradition, our school, it's called the Ja'fari school. Ja'fari is related to Imam Ja'far. Why this Imam is so important to us? There are two main reasons for his significance and his major role and major importance in the history of Islam and in particular the school of Ahlul Bayt. This Imam led two types of revolutions. One was the intellectual revolution. The second was the ethical revolution. And people need both. Ilm, science, and knowledge does not function without ethics. And ethics cannot produce without knowledge. They are intertwined. And this Imam came to a society that suffered from spiritual, moral, and intellectual drought. Therefore, he took upon himself, as his father did before him, the fifth Imam, Imam Muhammad al-Baqir alayhi salatu wassalam, took upon himself that we have to refurbish the ummah, refurbish their minds, their souls, their ethics. Imagine ummah that the Prophet spent time on them, nurturing them, teaching them, sacrificing for them, yet they murder his grandson. What sort of ummah is that? This is how they repay the Prophet for his service, for 23 years of preaching and teaching and sacrificing. 50 years after him, they murder his grandson. That ummah is not a normal ummah. There is something wrong with this ummah. There is something wrong, fundamentally wrong. Therefore, the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, after the martyrdom of Imam Hussein in Karbala in year 61, they decided that there is something wrong with this ummah. We have to work, we the leaders, we the educators. Allah has endowed us with this responsibility. Others, they are after sultan, after leadership and government and dominance. Banu Umayyah and Banu Abbas. Khalifa Fulan and Khalifa Fulan and Khalifa Fulan. Their focus is not to teach people. Their focus is to grab power and dominate and rule by force and plunder the nation's wealth. And they don't care whether people are educated, non-educated, aware, unaware, religious, non-religious, good or bad, they don't care. As long as the throne is safe. But our imams are different. Our imams, Allah says about them in the Holy Quran, تِلْكَ الدَّارُ الْآخِرَةِ نَجْعَلُهَا لِلَّذِينَ لَا يُرِيدُونَ عُلُوًا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فَسَادًا وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. That, the hereafter. We make it, we design it, we provide it for those who seek no conceit, nor transgression on this land. They seek no conceit, no arrogance, neither transgression. لِلَّذِينَ لَا يُرِيدُونَ عُلُوًا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَا فَسَادًا. Those are our imams. They were not dying to rule. Beginning with Imam Ali alayhi salam. Imam Ali, even when he was sitting in his small room for 25 years, he was producing, he was working. Imam Ali compiled the Holy Quran after the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That was his first achievement and first work. Our imams are not unemployed. They have nothing to do. Their presence is barakah and a blessing every day, every hour, every minute, every second. They work. So they do not aspire to become leaders. Even this imam who was murdered by the second Abbasite caliph. And this Abbasite caliph is the cousin of the imam, it's not someone who is foreigner. This Abbasite caliph al-Mansur who murdered Imam al-Sadiq, he's his cousin. Al-Mansur is the son of Muhammad, the son of Ali, the son of Abdullah ibn Abbas. Abdullah ibn Abbas is the closest friend of Imam Ali alayhi salam, the closest friend. After the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Imam Ali is Abdullah ibn Abbas. His first cousin, Abbas, being the uncle of the Prophet and Imam Ali, Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib. This is his son, Abdullah, was a close friend of Imam Ali, the close disciple of Imam Ali. So he had a son by the name of Ali, after Ali Muhammad, after Muhammad came Al-Mansur, who murdered the Imam al-Sadiq. Al-Mansur, and before him his brother Abu al-Abbas al-Saffah, they came to power carrying the name of Al-Muhammad. They said, we have to take the right from Bani Umayyah and give it to Ahlul Bayt. This was their slogan when they came to power. This is how they deceived the masses. In the name of democracy, in the name of restoring power to the legitimate leaders, while Ahlul Bayt, they came to power. People believed them. People from Khorasan all the way to the east, in Egypt, in North Africa, in Yemen, in Syria, in Iraq, they believed them. That those are genuine, they are the cousins of Ahlul Bayt. They're going to take the power from Bani Umayyah and give it back to Ahlul Bayt. But when they reached power, they immediately started persecuting Ahlul Bayt. They started with murdering the leader of Ahlul Bayt at that time, Al-Imam Ja'far ibn Muhammad al-Assad. Mansur al-Abbasi, he was in Baghdad, He was the one who built Baghdad. Mansur was the one who built the city of Baghdad. So his capital and his seat of Khilafah was in Baghdad. And he would call the Imam several times all the way from Medina to Baghdad just to insult him, just to threaten him, just to intimidate him. 7 times. At that time, there were no airplanes. Even today, if you take a flight from Medina to Baghdad, it will take at least 2 hours. Imagine at that time how many days it would take to take the Imam handcuffed from his city of Medina, bring him to Baghdad. He stands before Mansur. Mansur threatens him, intimidates him, slanders him, and he sends him back to Medina. 7 times. With a leader, not like any leader. Imam al-Sadiq is the leader of the four madahib. Imam al-Sadiq is the teacher of Abu Hanifa and the teacher of Malik ibn Anas. Those two leaders of Sunni traditions, the Hanafi and the Maliki. And then indirectly, he's the teacher of Shafi'i and Ahmad ibn Hanbal. So he's the teacher of the four, the top leaders of the Sunni traditions. He's their mentor and their teacher and their educator. This man, Mansur al-Abbas, he brings him 7 times. And the last time, he poisons him and he kills the Imam. At the age of 68. At the age of 68. But the Imams, they were ready for this sacrifice. Nothing would put them down. Nothing will discourage them from the path, straight path of resistance, of spreading the knowledge of the Holy Quran and the knowledge of their grandfather Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
There is an amazing book. I showed this book maybe last year or 2 years before here. This book is the compilation of essays written in a conference, intellectual conference that took place in 1970 in Paris, France. About 20 professors, orientalists, mustashriqeen, including one of them was from UCLA, participated in this conference more than 40 years ago, 1970, in Paris, France, and they compiled their essays and their speeches and presentations in this book. This book was originally written in French, and then it was translated to Arabic and Farsi. And the one who translated it to Arabic is the late Dr. Nuruddin Al-Ali. May Allah bless his soul, who passed away a few months or, you know, maybe a couple of years ago. And he gave a speech at this center. He was the one who, because he studied at Sorbonne in France, and he translated the book from English, from French to Farsi and Arabic, 2 languages. In this book, marvelous book, when you read this book, you find that 20 non-Muslim professors, non-Muslim, none of them is Muslim, neither Shi'as, from France, from Germany, from Switzerland, from the UK, from the United States, and other countries, they praise Imam al-Sadiq. They highly speak about him, and each professor speaks about one dimension of his greatness. One professor speaks about Imam being one of the founders of modern tib, ilm al-tib, medicine. Another one gives a paper on Imam al-Sadiq being the founder of modern chemistry. Another professor speaks about astrology, astronomy, applied science, mathematics. So Imam al-Sadiq was not only a scholar of religion or Holy Quran or Hadith. He was also a teacher, professor, a theorist of all other sciences at that time. One of the things that Imam al-Sadiq said at the age of 11, And no one can say this unless he is inspired by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, the first person who, before people thought that the earth is a plane, it's not round shaped. This was the thinking. Even today, some genius people in Saudi Arabia, they think that the earth is a plane, alhamdulillah. You know that? Believe me, even today. Some of them are mashayikh, when they speak, they say it can't be. Earth is plain, you know. They can't imagine. Their brain, mashallah, is so beautifully, you know, programmed that they cannot imagine that the earth has a round shape or spherical, as we say. The first person who said the earth is spherical is Ptolemy. We studied this when we were kids in the school.
Galileo.
No, no. Ptolemy, before him, in the second century, about 18 or 19 centuries ago. And then Galileo came later on, many centuries after that, in the 15th century. Again, he came and he reinforced this idea that the earth is spherical. And he was prosecuted, you know, Galileo was prosecuted. The church at that time in Europe, they said to him, this is a heresy, kufr, what you are saying. It's a heresy. And many scientists were killed by the church. At the time where Islam was advancing in science, don't look at Islam today, don't look at ISIS. ISIS do not represent the true Islam. The true Islam is represented by Imam Al-Baqir, Imam Al-Saddiq, our Imams. Imam came in the 7th century, 600, almost 560 years after Ptolemy, Batlimus. The Arabs, they call him, or the Muslims, they call him Batlimus. Ptolemy believed that the earth, the sun rotates around the earth, and the earth is the center of the universe at that time. Imam Sadiq, at the age of 11, he proved scientifically to his students in the city of Al-Madinah Al-Munawwarah that the earth rotates around itself and around what? The sun. That was the first man ever among the Christians, the Muslims, the Jews, who stated that the earth, and that is 1300 years ago, in the 7th century, it is recorded that the Imam was the first one who said, no, the earth is not the center of the universe. The earth belongs to the solar system. It rotates around itself to create the day, and around the sun to create the year. And the Imam, he takes that from the Holy Quran, a theory in the Holy Quran. والشمس تجري لمستقر لها ذلك تقدير العزيز العليم والقمر قدرناه منازل حتى عاد كالعرجون القديم لا الشمس ينبغي لها أن تدرك القمر ولا الليل سابق النهار وكل في فلك يسبحون. So the Holy Quran. But some people, they read the Quran, they don't understand it. Allah made Ahlul Bayt the translators and the interpreters of this book, the Holy Quran. This is why we love them. We love Ahlul Bayt. We take them to heart, because without them, people cannot understand this book. Or maybe they would misunderstand it, as some scholars, even today in Saudi Arabia, they misunderstand the Quran. They believe that the earth is straight. You move from here, and he says, because you move, how does this Saudi cleric prove that the earth is plane? He says, because you move, take a train from here, a camel, whatever, donkey, keep moving, you don't fall. So the earth is plane, subhanAllah. Very genius. This is now, in the 21st century. And those people, they want to establish the Islamic Khilafah. Those people are the pioneers of Salafism and Takfirism and ISIS and Al-Qaeda and Boko Haram and Shabab and every backward terrorist organization on earth. And still, America considers Saudi Arabia its strongest allies, believe me. Our strongest allies are two, Israel and Saudi Arabia. Imam Al-Saddiq came to lead a revolution. Revolution, intellectual revolution. Islam was in danger at that time. At that time, Banu Umayyah were collapsing, and they gave way to heretics, to polytheists, to others, to come and question Islam and question the Holy Quran. Many of the philosophers at that time, they would come and they say, there are faults in this book. And no one would answer them, except Ahlul Bayt. Ahlul Bayt would stand to defend Islam from the time of Imam al-Baqir, again Imam al-Sadiq, until the time of Imam al-Ridha. Imam al-Ridha spent much of his time, especially in Khorasan, and in 2 weeks we're going to celebrate his birthday here, inshallah. Not next Thursday, the Thursday after that. So the celebration of the Milad of our eighth Imam, Al-Imam Ali ibn Musa Ridha, alayhi salatu wasalam. Most of his time, Imam al-Ridha was spent dialoguing with interfaith leaders, the leaders of the Jewish community, the Sabian community, the Zoroastrian community, the Christian community, dialoguing with them. They converse people through mantiq, logic. Al-Rahman allama al-Qur'ana khalaqa al-insana allamahu al-bayan. Bayan is logic. When you have logic, you win. People who use weapon to crush others, they don't have logic. They don't have logic. They use anger. They use emotions. They use frustration. But when people have logic, they don't have to be angry. They don't have to be frustrated. They have logic. Our imams, they taught us to use logic when we speak. Burhan, qul hatu burhanakum in kuntum sadiqin. Imam Malik says, لا رأت عين ما رأت عين ولا سمعت أذن ولا خطر على قلب بشر أفضل من جعفر بن محمد الصادق. Imam Malik ibn Anas, the leader of the Maliki tradition, is an intellectual man, a knowledgeable man, truly knowledgeable man. He says, no eyes have seen, no ears have heard, no brain, no thoughts have ever thought of someone greater in piety, in knowledge, in righteousness, in honesty, than Imam Ja'far ibn Muhammad al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam. This is the testimony of one of his students who was instructed under the leadership of Imam al-Sadiq. Imam al-Sadiq was not biased. He will teach all Muslims. He doesn't care who's Sunni, who's Shi'a, who's Christian, who's Muslim. In his lesson, which almost 4,000 people would gather, 4,000 students of his university. There were agnostics, there were atheists, there were Muslims, there were Shias, there were Sunnis, there were all sorts of people. An open university for all. This is how you should be. This is how our imams, they disseminate their knowledge without reservation, without boycotting this group or that group. This is the policy of our Prophet. قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِلَيْكُمْ جَمِيعًا. I'm the messenger of God to all mankind. To all mankind. Allah wants me to preach my message to all mankind. So Imam alayhi salam was pro-interfaith, pro-intra-faith. He would speak with all, and people would benefit from him. And this is why 20 non-Muslim professors, they come after 13 centuries to gather in Paris to praise this man, this Imam. Al-Imam al-Saddiq, to speak highly about him. Let me say something, because tomorrow I'm going to continue. We need days to speak about this Imam. But let me say what the Imam said. A story, two stories. One is Al-Mansur. Mansur al-Abbasi was the Abbasite Caliph, the second Abbasite Caliph. In Baghdad, he came to Medina. So all scholars, they go and visit him. Of course, the Caliph is there, they have to visit him. Except Imam al-Sadiq, he did not go to visit him. He's a tyrant, this man is a tyrant. This man is corrupt. So he sent a message to the Imam. He said to him, Yabna Rasulullah, O the son of the Prophet of God, لِمَ لَا تَخْشَانَا كَمَا يَخْشَانَ النَّاسِ. Why don't you come and visit the Caliph just like other people when they come and visit? Why don't visit? Listen to the answer of the Imam. This is what makes Imam al-Sadiq great. This answer. Pay attention to this answer. This answer distinguishes the Imams of Ahlul Bayt from others. This is, if you want to know why our Imams are great, listen to the answer. The Imam said to him, ليس لنا من أمر الدنيا ما نخافك عليه ولا عندك من أمر الآخرة ما نرجوه منك. Imam said to him, I don't come and visit you because of two reasons. One reason, I don't have corporations and companies and lands and properties, so I feel that you're going to confiscate that from me and take it away from me. I have no business in this land, nothing. My bank account, zero balance. Why should I fear the government? Why should I fear the IRS or the FBI? When your bank account is zero, you don't own anything. Why do you fear? Some people, they fear the government, especially in the Middle East, because they take away their land, their homes, their properties, their bank accounts, their assets. Imam says, I have nothing in this dunya that I am worried about because of you, the Sultan. And more interestingly, more importantly, وَلَا عِنْدَكَ مِنْ أَمْرِ الْآخِرَةِ مَا نَرْجُهُ مِنْكَ. Neither you have something of the akhirah, a good virtue that I come and learn from you. You are bankrupt. Why should I come? To learn ilm from you, knowledge, piety, honesty, truthfulness. You have nothing. You are a corrupt person. Why do you want me to waste my time and come and visit you? Mansur was smart. See? Mansur said to him, No. I know. I have nothing of the akhirah. Neither you have something for the dunya, of the dunya. But you come only tashabana litansahana. Just come and visit me to advise me. Give me an advice. Listen to the answer. Imam says to him, من يريد الدنيا لا ينصحك ومن يريد الآخرة لا يصحب. The one, if someone is seeking dunya, he would not give a good advice to a tyrant. Someone who's seeking the dunya, he would not go to the tyrant and tells him, don't kill, don't destroy, don't steal, because he's a thief himself, so he wants the tyrant to help him. من يريد الدنيا كسي كدنيا لم يخاط نمي أترى نصيحات كنان. وَمَنْ يُرِيدُ الْآخِرَةَ لَا يَصْحَبُكَ. And someone who seeks the Akhirah would not come and sit with you next to you. This is Imam al-Sadiq. Those are our leaders. Do you know why Al-Mansur murders him? Do you know why? Because the only threat to dictatorship, injustice, corruption of the caliphs and the sultans were Ahlul Bayt. They did not see in others as threats, only in Ahlul Bayt. 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago, how many of you heard of WikiLeaks leaks regarding Saudi Arabia? Did you read, do you follow the news? There were articles on the Los Angeles Times, New York Times, everywhere. The cables that Saudi embassies they sent to the foreign ministry in Riyadh, they were exposed and leaked. Thousands of documents. When you study them, when you research them, according to the New York Times, the only concern Saudi Arabia has in this world is Shi'ism and Iran. Nothing else. They only advise their ambassadors, be careful of Shi'ism in Thailand, in the Philippines, in Bangladesh, in Pakistan, in America, in Europe, in this country and that country. The only thing that, the only concern that, the anxiety that they have is the spread of Shi'ism today. They have no other concern, by the way, no other concern. No other concern. Only the truth. The spreading of truth of the school of Ahlul Bayt. This is exactly what Banu al-Abbas and Banu Umayyah they had during the time of Imam Hussein, Imam Zain al-Abidin, Imam Muhammad al-Baqir, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, Imam Musa al-Qadhi, Imam Ali al-Ridha. This is why they murdered them. They had no other thing that would bother them except Ahlul Bayt, the message of Ahlul Bayt. Because the message of Ahlul Bayt is the message of the truth. And tyrants, they worry, they are afraid of the truth. They are not afraid of falsehood. Tyrants are always afraid of the truth. But Allah says, whatever they do, ultimately truth is going to prevail. I always say to my friends, the scholars and others, that I am not worried about the future of Shia Islam. I'm not worried. Not because we have money and we have books and we have... No. We have nothing. Resources, zero. But because this is the truth. And the truth is self-powered. Self-powered. Once people are exposed to the truth, they find it. Many people, they try to conceal it from their children. From their own children. Yet he finds after 10 years that his son is a Shia. The father tried hard for his children not to hear about Shia. Shish, don't say anything. No, don't mention Hussein, don't mention Ashura, don't mention. But then the children, they go and they discover. And then they tell their parents, you cheated on me. For 20 years you cheated on me. This is what we see on a daily basis. Amir al-Mu'mineen says, al-Haqqu jadid. Don't worry about Haqq. Haqq is always a flesh. Even if it comes after 50 years. It's a flesh. They cannot crush the heart. One last thing from Imam al-Saddiq alayhi salatu wassalam. This is for us, for me and you and you and you and you and all of us. This is a message for us. Private message. Special message for us. He says, كُونُوا زَيْنًا لَنَا وَلَا تَكُونُوا شَيْنًا عَلَيْنَا. Imam al-Saddiq says to me and you and all of us, be all my followers, all the Shia of Ahlul Bayt, be an attraction, an ornament for Ahlul Bayt, Zaynan lana. Do not be a distraction for Ahlul Bayt. So when you act, when you behave in a nice way that people say, yes, those are the students, the followers, and the lovers of Ahlul Bayt. Are we acting in this manner? Do we act as the true Shia of Imam al-Saddiq? In our relationships, at home, outside home, with our friends, with our family members, with our children, do we act that way? Zayn, we become attraction for Ahlul Bayt? Do we? Kunu zaynan lana. وَلَا تَكُونُوا شَيْنًا عَلَيْنَا حَتَّى يَقُولَ النَّاسِ. When people look at you behave well, they say, رَحِمَ اللَّهُ جَعْفَرًا فَلَقَدْ أَدَّبَ شِيعَةً. May God bless the soul of Imam al-Sadiq. He taught his followers very well. He disciplined them very well. You are ambassadors of Imam Al-Saddiq, all of you. When you go home, think about this. Always think. When you go outside, when you go to school, when you go to the marketplace, when you drive, when you deal with people, when you speak with people, always remember that you are the ambassador of Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wassalam. I will recite Amman Yujib, because we have dear friends and family members and sisters and brothers in our community who really, really need your dua. And the only window of or opportunity of help and salvation for them is your sincere prayers. When you pray, do dua from the bottom of your heart, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows healing and salvation on them, inshallah. A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Amman yujibul mudharra idha da'ah wa yakshifu as-su'. أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء 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 يا الله من على مرضانا بالشفاء والعافية المريضة المنظورة اللهم ألبسها ثوب الصحة والعافية عاجلا الفاتحة مع الصلاة على محمد وآل محمد